Okay. This is a concept that you gotta get. So we had to have a break when we had a break. This is where I have lost people in the past. Okay? On this topic. Vectors. My dad tells me I shouldn't even teach this part. Because he just doesn't think I should teach it because it's too complicated. But I think it's like conjugating a verb, right? If you want to speak the language, you got to know some of these things that are difficult to understand. Okay? Bad analogy. But, vectors. A vector is a geometric entity characterized by magnitude and direction. That's what it is. Okay? So it's like a big arrow pointing in this direction for an entity that is following that, right? So a big charge from point A to point B gets a large vector pointing. It's represented by a large arrow, okay? A small charge going from point B to point C gets a little arrow pointing in that direction, okay? That's a vector. Okay? And we use vectors as a way to describe the flow of depolarization events through the heart. Okay? Does that make sense? So I have to start at point A, which is generally my sinus node. Okay? And that electrical signal passes to my ventricle, which is generally down kind of in the lower left-hand corner of my mediastinum, right? So I generally describe that direction of depolarization with an arrow that points this way, okay? That is the vector that represents the depolarization event, okay? When I have an electrical signal traveling in a direction that can be detected, it is either positive or negative, okay? So an electrical signal either comes at me or it goes away from me. But you've got to remember, when I'm trying to detect the signal, I have to define myself in a one D, is there anything that's one dimension? Is it one dimension, two dimensional? Would it be two-dimensional? Flat. So it's flat, but it doesn't have up and down or sideways flat, and it has not. It can't be out here. It can only be one. So that's like one directional. One dimensional. Yeah, it's like tunnel vision. That's great. Tunnel vision, right? That's all I get is what's coming straight at me. Everybody, get out your empty toilet paper roll, right? And you look down, and all I can see is what's directly in front of me, and it's either moving towards me or it's moving away from me. Okay? You're either moving away from me or towards me. Okay? And if you're moving at an angle, I only see the portion of you that moves towards me or away from me. Okay? So if I'm set up like in lead one, which goes from my... It's been working out. Right? So lead one detects things that move in this direction, negative, positive, right? So if I look at this and I say, all right, well, my movement goes from here to here, okay? Well, I can split this movement into two axes. One is this direction, and the second part of that is this direction, right? That makes up this movement. But I only can see this portion of it. Okay? Which is significantly smaller than what the true signal was, right? It's only a portion of that. It's not as big. It only represents the portion that moves in that direction. Does that make sense? What's so funny? You're like my diagram.
It's not so beautiful. It's beautiful.
That's lead one, right?
It's lead one.
If That makes sense right there.
There you go. Everybody go home.
But you put a limb lead on.
Right.
And then you put another limb lead on here, and you don't have your patients.
Doesn't matter.
Okay.
I'm not.
Now it's getting ugly. But, right?
Yeah.
So, here's an electrode, and here's an electrode on this Gumby, right? I don't send the signal through space this direction, right?
Yeah, it goes.
It goes up here and around here and down here. But what that does is it tells me what goes across here to here, okay? So you've seen where people put them here, put them here, put them here, put them here. Mm-hmm. But as I'm told, and you'd be in a bucket, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what it's detecting is what comes across the signal, because right, I'm defined by what's my heart right here, right? So I'm coming across this way. Einthoven's triangle is like this, right? Here's my other little lead down here. So I'm going to have 1, 2, 3, right? Those are my original leads, 1, 2, and 3.
Is that related to the amplitude of the...
It is related to the amplitude in terms of how much you are moving towards me and how much you are moving away from me. Okay?
I should say all this on my t-shirt.
You look like a train car. Scribble. That makes sense. What a vector is, right? So I set up my leads as a bunch of perspectives with my empty toilet paper roll, okay? But those are now in three dimensions, right? I got limb leads that make up Einthoven's triangle. So lead one goes here. It detects things that move from right to left, okay? From this electrode or whatever we want to call it, this sticker, this sticker. What happens in this direction is lead one. What happens in this direction is lead two. What happens in this direction is lead three. And then I take those and I create my accessory lens or my accessory leads or my augmented leads. And I say, all right, let's bisect each one of these. So I bisect lead one, and that gives me AVL. Bisect lead two, that gives me, I'm sorry, AVF. Bisect lead two, that gives me AVL. Bisect lead three, that gives me AVR. Okay? So now I have several different perspectives. I have AVR is looking at the heart. This is my heart. Here's a heart. Here's my heart, right? Here's my heart right there. Okay? So AVR is looking at my heart from this perspective. Okay? AVL is looking at things from this perspective. Lead one is looking at them from this perspective, right? Leads two, three, and AVF are looking at it from the bottom perspective, right? And each one is just saying what's moving towards me, what's moving away from me, right? Make sense? And now I'm going to add that third dimension, which is now I'm out here in the periphery looking towards the heart. V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6, right? And each one is a single perspective of a common event, right? Make sense? Each one is a single perspective of a common event. So if I lay these all out, this is what I'm detecting. Everything moves kind of generally in this direction, except AVR is the only outlier. So I open up a 12 lead. Look at any example 12 lead in here. Pull that thing open. Look at any normal rhythm, normal 12 lead. Look at 228. Actually, look at 214, look at 215, look at
216, look at 217, look at 218, look at 219, look at 220, look at 221. Every one of those. AVR is always down. Predominantly down. It's always negative. Okay?
But so is AVL.
Don't look at AVL yet. Okay? And I bet you if you go and look at all 10 of those again, AVL is not negative in every single one of them. AVR is negative in every single one of them. Okay? Because it is looking at what generally is an event that takes place from a sinus node that moves to the ventricles and a heart that's tipped towards this axis, right? So if I take a heart, it's usually tipped down with an apex down here and a right atrium right here. Generally, I'm going to move from right atrium to apex in this direction, right? Which is exactly the opposite of what AVR sees up here. So AVR, in a normal rhythm, always sees negative. Sees negative spikes. Everything's down. Okay? The only time I'm positive in AVR, or generally the only time I'm positive in AVR, if I have an impulse that's going from the apex up, like VTAC that starts in the apex, right? Because then I'm conducting from the apex up with ventricular tachycardia where my ectopic rhythm begins, my VTAC originates in the apex of the ventricle. Now I'm looking at a rhythm that goes just in the same direction as AVR. So now I'm upright in AVR. So a lot of AVR or a lot of VTAC will have a positive AVR if it's low in the apex of the ventricle. Okay?
Will you see a positive deflection in a junctional rhythm in AVR?
Generally not. Generally not because I'm still conducting from AV to ventricle. And my ventricles are still tipped favorably towards my left. Right? Still favorably tipped. Okay? What's the best lead to find a P wave?
Two.
Why is two the best lead to find a P wave?
That's the direction it's traveling.
Because, look, generally, I'm going to depolarize from the high right atrium through my atria to my AV node, which generally runs in the same direction as lead two. Okay?
Ventricular what rhythm was usually making it positive?
Ventricular tachycardia when it's at the apex. Remember, ventricular tachycardia can be anywhere in the ventricle, right? But if it originates in the apex, then it's going to go retrograde, okay? Now, let's say I have things like SVT. We talked about SVT, right? Or you've seen SVT in the past, and you hear about sometimes you can have a retrograde P wave, right? A retrograde P wave, right? Generally, my P waves are going to be positive. I don't know why I keep migrating to that board. I've got a perfectly good board right here. Thanks, Doc. So, SA node, AV node, fist bundle, left bundle, right bundle, okay? Lead two goes this direction, right? Positive, negative, okay? So if I go and conduct through my atria, I'm generally going to have depolarization that is positive, right? Well, let's say I have SVT, which is a reentry pathway right here. It's not originated at the SA node. It originates at the AV node and depolarizes this way rapidly, and it will depolarize the atrium in this direction. So what I get is my initial event is usually this fast conduction, right? So I have no P wave that starts it, followed by a retrograde P wave. And it's negative because it's moving the vector, the summation of these events through the atrium, moves in this direction. That's the vector. That vector is represented by upside down when it goes away from lead two. Make sense?
Yeah? Okay. It's right here. Okay? But you can see, I only see the portion that comes at me. I don't see this axis of it. I don't see that. So I only see this. It's a smaller spike because it's less of the signal. Right? My isoelectric lead is the one where I'm kind of like equivalent on either side. And then I can say I'm just about perpendicular to that lead. And we'll use this at times to say, all right, which is my isoelectric lead? I take my isoelectric lead on Einthoven's triangle, and instead of saying, hold on there.
So why isn't it just flat?
Actually, I'll get into that.
Why wouldn't it just be flat? Why does it have to be represented by up and down versus just being flat since it's not coming at you at all? Does it have to represent there's actual electrical activity or what?
Well, here's the hard part about that, is that, remember, I'm dealing with two hollow spheres, right? I'm dealing with two hollow spheres. And as I depolarize something, I'm going to, unless I start on an absolute periphery, right? Unless I start somewhere totally in the periphery, I'm going to get some component of bidirectional signal, okay? This is the summation of the event. It is the biggest element. Doesn't mean that there's not something in my direction away from my direction. It's just the summation. So let's take an isoelectric from lead. Here we'll say we're looking straight across lead one, okay? And if I'm going to depolarize here to here, remember I'm depolarizing like this, okay? So I'm not getting any of this stuff in here because that's space, right? But I depolarize in this fashion. So I move, there's direction, I'm putting a signal out in every direction, okay? I get a little bit this way, and I'm going to get a little bit this way at some point. Okay? But it is the summation. If I take all these and I add them all up, what is that event going to do? And in this circumstance, well, I get a little bit towards me, I get a little bit away from me, and the timing's not going to be absolutely the same because, remember, I've got an event that takes time. So, generally how that manifests is equal depolarization in both directions. Okay? Now, you can get some where you're just going to see this. Right? I hardly get anything at all. Right? Which one?
223.
Yeah, very, very, very small signal. And generally my isoelectric leads are going to be very, very, very small signal. But there is some signal, some of that component I'm going to see. Right? It's just a very small amount of it. Okay?
We throw that in the garbage, please. Thank you. Sorry. If I can't see it here, I'm sure people are struggling.
Okay, so here is an example of a conduction vector relationship. So let's look at lead 2. So lead 2, remember, I'm looking at things that come in this direction. And when I talk about positive and negative, we look at this page over here, anything that goes even remotely towards that negative side is going to be a negative deflection, right? So if here's lead 1 comes across this way, here's positive, here's negative. If I bisect that, anything that's on this side, be it here, 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 or even here, is going to be positive, okay? It's just going to be barely positive, right? And the more I approach
what I'm actually seeing, the bigger that gets. Anything out here that's on this half of that plane, on the negative side, is going to be negative deflection. How negative depends on how directly negative from that lead I am. Okay? So every axis, I'm going to bisect it, and anything that falls in the front 90 degrees of it is positive, anything that falls in the back 90 degrees is negative. That make sense? So when I look at lead 2, and I bisect lead 2, that's a negative deflection, right? That's primarily a negative event that starts out my QRS complex. Okay? As I proceed and as I depolarize, well, now I'm getting more of my ventricle, and if I take all these little guys and I sum them up, meaning I add them all together, I get this event, a big positive event in direction of lead 2, so I spike. Okay? As I continue to depolarize, I'm moving more towards this left ventricle because it's bigger, larger, more mass, more electrical signal. I'm still on this half on the positive side of lead 2. I'm not quite as positive as I was before, so I remain above the isoelectric line. I'm still positive, but I'm not as positive. And then ultimately, I get this little tail end, and all that's left is just this high left ventricle, and it's moving in this direction, so now I'm negative. I'm below the isoelectric line. Okay? Does that make sense? But we're working off an isoelectric line, right? So my isoelectric line is this line right here. Right? If I was in asystole, that's what you would see. Okay? It's my isoelectric line. I'm either positive off of that line or I'm negative off of that line. Okay? And negative deflections mean that that particular lead is seeing the electrical signal move away from it. Positive means that particular lead sees the signal moving towards it. Okay? So this is why, if I look at that exact same event, here's what I look like when I look at it from the perspective of lead 2, I look like this. Right? When I look at it from right here, right, that's lead 2, I look at it from here, it looks like this. When I look at it from AVF, it looks different. It's the same event, it's my perspective has changed. When I look at it from lead 1, right here, it's the same exact event, but my perspective has changed. So that's why I get a change in the appearance on the various different leads. Same exact event, visualized from a different perspective in the heart, and manifested by you move towards me, you go up. You move away from me, you go down. Okay? That makes sense?
They said it was the sum of all the...
The sum of the events at any one point...
It's not the sum of energy. It's not the sum of the total mass of...
It's not energy.
It's not.
Well, it's the sum of the...
It's not 0.5 millivolts.
I'm looking at millivolts.
Yeah.
I'm looking at millivolts, and I'm looking at them at any one perspective, right? So if I go like this, and I'm looking at the QRS complex, right? Right now, it represents whatever signal as a summation of events. If I take them all and I say it's predominantly positive or predominantly, give me this point here. It's positive, right? The next millisecond, it measures it again. And I'm right here. The next millisecond, I'm right here, right? So it gives me this global appearance, right? So in that lead, I can say overall the whole cardiac cycle, the whole entire cardiac cycle, made a predominant positive move in the direction of lead 2. Okay? Because I have a big predominant QRS depolarization that's positive. Okay? In general, it looked like it was probably perpendicular to lead,
was positive 2, and I'm going to say I was
probably perpendicular to lead 3. Okay? Because I'm pretty isoelectric. The whole event, if I say, all right, the whole thing looked like a net zero in terms of contribution of where that signal went. Okay? Now, so the summation, or the mapping at each moment gives me this. Okay? Now, if I take my entire leads 2, 3, AVF, and I, or 1, 2, 3, and AVF, AVR, and AVL, if I take those six limb leads and augmented leads, right? I take those and I create an axis diagram, and we'll do that in just a second, right? When I talk about axis, axis is taking all six of those leads and saying, all right, you contributed this much, you contributed this much, lead AVF, you contributed this much, right? You sum that all together into one axis, and that's your QRS axis. So each one is kind of adding electrical signals to give me axis of that event. So I can determine a P wave axis, I can determine a QRS axis, I can determine all of these things based on, in leads 1, 2, 3, AVL, AVR, and AVF, I take the net positive or negative and I said it moved in this direction. Okay? We'll get to axis a little bit more in just a second. So you can understand why it deviates the way it does based on this, right? So each lead gives its own electrical interpretation from its respective position. Leads are going to look differently because they view the impulse from the SA node through the conduction system and into the ventricular myocardium from different perspectives or different angles. Upward deflections indicate current traveling towards a lead. Negative deflections indicate a current traveling away from the lead.
Right?
Yeah. So what is this? Don't look at the picture. Look at the EKG. What do you see here? What's unique about these? Lead 2 and 3, leads 5 and V6. Mm-hmm. So inferior leads that are looking up from the bottom of the heart, lateral leads that are looking out from the side of the heart. What do you see?
You're missing part of the QRS.
Huh?
You're missing part of the QRS.
Well, they each have a QRS,
but
there's beat-to-beat variability. Each one is preceded by a P wave, right? I'm dealing with a rhythm that is regular, perfectly regular. I have a P wave that is a normal appearing. They all look the same. So I know I'm originating from the same part of the atrium in every single one. That, by all other definitions, is sinus. But then why do I have beat-to-beat variability in the amplitude of my QRS complex?
Is that a paste? Mm-hmm.
It's not paste, because paste would mean it's the same thing. So either, nope, it's not a block.
Is it not
pressure
when
he breathes in?
Hmm?
Is pressure when he breathes in?
What do you mean, kind of, what do you mean pressure?
Paradigmatic pressure, like pulses
paradoxus. No, because that pulses paradoxus is not an electrical manifestation. It's a blood pressure manifestation.
With the amount of sodium and calcium?
Nope. Nope, because that's beat to beat variability. I'm not going to change that much.
So
I'm not going to have a sodium 120.
What's the other
ventricle? It's just expelling less energy.
Nope, same amount of energy.
Each beat?
Yep, same amount of energy, right? So I lost energy here, but I have energy, that same amount of energy here. Now I have less, I'm detecting less of a signal, but I got more of a signal.
Why?
So the net event is the same. The whole time, the net event is the same. I see it really well this beat,
I don't see it so well the next beat. I see it really well this beat. I don't see it so well the next beat. Right. How do I move my perspective of the heart?
The heart's moving.
Yeah, my heart's moving.
Are you talking? Right?
My heart is moving. It's either my heart's moving or I've changed the position of my leads every single beat to beat. Right? So I got a coordinated movement of my, right? I suppose if you tried to catch somebody jogging and they jog like this and they got this beat to beat that matches their heart perfectly, then it would look different each time, right? But that's impossible. Okay? Sorry you had to see that. But if I move my heart and it flip-flops around, well, when it flips towards me, when you flip the ventricle towards me, I see a big signal. When you flip the ventricle away from me, I don't see the signal as well. But they see it down here better. This is a phenomenon called electrical alternans. And you see it with big pleural or big pericardial effusions.
Yeah, pericardial effusions.
Effusions. I want this to play so it makes sense.
Electrical alternans?
Electrical alternans. It doesn't matter that you know what electrical alternans is. It doesn't matter. Right? Doesn't matter. Okay? You know how many times I've seen it? Like twice. Twice. Okay? I don't care if it's on the test. I hope you all get it wrong. Right? I don't care if it's on the test. What I care about is, do you understand what I'm trying to explain to you in terms of high voltage, low voltage? High voltage, low voltage. It's how much electrical signal I see at that moment. I all want you to do well on the test, damn it. Don't, you know what I mean? I have to make this play so it makes sense.
Does the heart beating itself, is that what causes it to move? Is that why it's such so regular?
Say that again.
So the rate is regular, and it's regularly every other beat is looks the same, right? So is it the heart beating itself that moves the heart?
Yeah, it's the heartbeat that's swinging. So I flipped it upside down so it made more sense. But when I have beat-to-beat variability and that heart swings inside the pericardium, and when it swings towards that lead, it sees a bigger voltage. When it swings away from that lead, it sees a smaller voltage. You'll see things like big pericardial effusions in people with, it's a slow, right? If this happened over 5 minutes, that's pericardial tamponade and they're dead, right? So, but a slow accumulation of fluid, like some people with uremic pericarditis, renal failure patients can have this. Some cancer patients can have this. People that third space a lot, so people with liver disease will sometimes get it, not a lot. People with CHF will sometimes get it, but not a lot. It's a rare condition, but when you see it, it can manifest as a swinging heart, right? And either I'm alternating the position of my leads with beat-to-beat variability, or I'm alternating the position of my heart with beat-to-beat variability. And when I got a swinging heart and a big sac that was a potential space, now it's a space full of fluid, it goes, right? Make sense?
Yep.
What's so funny?
I'm not going to say it.
Don't say it. What did I do?
We were all thinking it, though. I dare someone in this class to say it.
Don't say it. I don't want to know. You just make me blush. Where the hell am I at?
So can they just be sitting still?
Yeah.
And it just starts doing that?
Well, it happens over time, right? Right. Probably it's swinging around in there, and then finally one day they're like, well, I'm going to call 911 because I got nothing better to do today, right? So they call you, and you say, let's do a 12 lead, okay? You go pop, 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 and you see beat-to-beat variability. You say, electrical alternators. I know what that is. That heart's got to be moving around because this guy's not running like this, right?
So how does it sound? I mean, like, how...
So you'll have muffled heart sounds because you're listening to the heart through a bag of fluid.
Right.
So you'll have muffled heart sounds, generally.
Okay.
you won't hear a big difference because it has nothing to do with the mechanics of the heart. The valves are still going to slap together, give me heart sounds, but the electrical signal will be picked up differently. Okay. Beat-to-beat variability. Got it? Okay. So vectors and axis. So we get vectors, right? You get amplitude, you get vectors, you get conduction at this point, right? So we're making progress. If I take my leads and I put them into a wheel like this, this is how I determine axis, okay? So I'm going to put my heart right in the middle of this, right? Because I know my heart is right in the middle of these leads. Eindhoven's triangle surrounds the heart. But let's take lead one and let's drop it into this 0 to 180 axis. Let's take lead two and move it over to this 60 to negative 120 axis. We'll take lead three and we'll move it into this negative 60, 120 axis. AVF now becomes 90 to 90, right? See what I'm doing here? AVR goes like this, or AVL goes like this, and AVR goes like this, right? Now I have a wheel. I have the same directional characteristics of each lead, but I just center everything right in the middle, okay? Make sense? Now I can determine axis, which is the summation of all of those leads that are included here, 1, 2, 3, AVL, AVR, AVF. It's the summation event in its entirety of a cardiac cycle. I can determine an axis. Okay? And the vast majority of that electrical signal moves from top right to bottom left. And we'll fall into this space. And this is considered normal axis. Okay? Does that make sense? Right? Now remember we talked about if I start in my left ventricle, down at the apex of my left ventricle, then I actually trigger an event that starts down here, and I depolarize in this direction. Right? So I'm going to be predominantly in this negative 20 to negative 150 axis. That's called extreme axis, okay? So all you got to do with axis is say, what defines normal? What defines normal? Negative, that's generous. Generally, what defines normal is lead 1 defines normal, and lead AVF defines this boundary of normal. Okay, so when I want to determine axis, I look at lead 1 and I look at lead AVS. And we'll go over that in a little more detail, but you need to understand they are the ones that divide and give me this quadrant. If I'm positive...
Well, it's gray on the up to the negative 30, so...
That's left... Technically, yeah, there's some debate about what we should call left axis. This, some people call 0 to negative 30 the leftward axis, but simplify it. Truthfully, there's no condition where it's life-threatening that if you call this left axis, they're going to die, right? So I just say it's easier to define this as 0 to 90, okay? And it's so far served me well, okay? So I look at lead 1 because it gives me 0 degrees, and I look at lead AVF because it gives me 90 degrees. And remember, if I am positive in AVF, 0 bisects the perpendicular of AVF, right? So if I'm positive in AVF, then I'm going to fall in this side of that axis diagram, right? So here's our axis diagram. So I'm going to fall on that side of it, right? If I'm positive in lead 1, I'm going to fall on this side of that axis diagram. So if I'm positive in 1 and I'm positive in F, then I know I'm defined in this quadrant. If I'm positive in 1 but I am negative in AVF, that puts me at left axis deviation. If I'm negative in one, puts me on this side, but positive in AVF, then I'm right axis deviation. If I'm negative in one, and I'm negative in AVF, that puts me in extreme axis deviation, which is where I see that retrograde event from the apex backwards. But I'll be positive in AVR, right? Because AVR detects things that go this direction. Clear as mud?
Extreme
axis. Don't worry, we're going to go over this again in just a second. I'm going to teach you a rule, thumb rule.
Are vectors and weights the same thing?
No. Okay. No. A vector is a magnitude in a direction. It is a symbol used for magnitude and direction, much like we use a symbol for axis. Okay? And we use that symbol of positive and negative. A lead is an electrical, is the millivolt, it measures a millivoltage as a positive negative gradient. But a vector is just a geometric descriptor that we use, a geometric symbol. So it's the arrows that I keep drawing, is the vector. And it describes the magnitude and direction of what that lead detects. Okay? But again, I've got to, for a vector to make sense, it's not time zero. It's not a point in time, right? It's the summation of that event. And I have to take, what was that event? Some of it might have been negative, some of it might have been positive. What was greater? And let's put it into a symbol that's easy to define. Okay? So it's a representation of what happened during that lead event. Okay?
So it would be like a, the whole QRS in lead one would be a vector?
No, the whole QRS in lead one is that summation of the depolarization event from the perspective of lead one. I can describe that with an arrow. It moved towards me or it moved away from me. Where that really comes into play is when I say, all right, I'm going to look at all of those, and I'm going to look at the summative signal of each one, and I'm going to add them all together. And the majority of that signal moved towards 30 degrees.
So would it be like a number and a direction?
A magnitude and a direction.
So a number
magnitude and
bolts,
a direction.
And then a arrow to the left arm would be a vector?
Mm-hmm. Or same. A big arrow pointing to my left arm and a small arrow pointing to my foot, right?
And that's
a vector, right? But we only use vectors when we're trying to describe the event that takes place. You never describe an EKG as a positive vector EKG, right? I describe it as I am normal axis.
Okay.
So we use a vector to demonstrate where we throw out this summation of the electrical event. And we define that by axis. And axis requires some sort of degree.
An axis,
right?
Divides the electrical activity into quadrants.
Yes, or more than quadrants. It technically, it's like a pizza. You have a couple of big slices, a couple of small slices, right? So it gives me, it divides it up, and I'll be able to use this in a number of different ways. Don't worry, we're going to get more into axis, okay? But this is just, this is the building block. It's the foundation. You just need to understand the concepts at this point. We will hammer out the details, okay? Okay, EKG interpretation. So that is the beginning, okay? That is the language of electrophysiology, okay? That is the language of EKGs. Now that you know how to read, I can give you a new book that you've never seen before, and you can read that book and tell me what happened. Okay? Right? We're going to start with easy books. Right? Dick and Jane. Right? C-spot run. Okay? By the time this is done, we'll be doing like Leo Tolstoy and stuff like that. Well, I don't know about that.
Can you take this Tolstoy like the very first day?
Yes. Tolstoy? What are you talking about? The first day?
And not spot run.
Well.
We're going to use this for you.
Hey, so I used it. You don't recall when I came in the first anatomy and physiology review was really what we talked about today. A lot of that was just slides I took right out of this lecture. So this is the second time you've seen a lot of this. First time was an AMP review. Yes. It was. Damn it.
I swear. You're such a liar.
We'll go back to the
video
tape on that one.
You have video
evidence.
But truthfully, we've kind of dabbled in this. You guys are in the environment of cardiology now. You've kind of starting to get some of the concepts. The problem is so much of EKG is pattern recognition, right? Now that you're kind of starting to get a feel for the language, right? You understand tonation and inflection in the language. Now we can start to say, all right, here's how you read. Here's the alphabet, right? Now we can really start to make progress, because once you have a foundation like that, everything else should be able to be built off of that, okay? Good? Okay. So, ECG interpretation. You have to have a systematic approach. EKGs can be distracting and busy, not to mention the crazy ones are usually correlating with a sick patient, right? So you have the added stress of, holy shit, what's this? I don't know what this rhythm is. And this guy looks like he's going to die, right? And then I say, what's the rhythm, right? Make a decision. It's not easy, okay? So you have to have a very systematic approach so that you can navigate it in a period of chaos when you may not completely understand what's taking place. And at least say, all right, based on what I know, based on what I see here, I can make several inferences, and I'm going to treat this way, okay? The beauty of unstable cardiac rhythms is they all filter down to electricity or chest compressions, right? So really, if you stall long enough, you're going to do one or the other, okay? So really simplify. It's like a pyramid, right? I mean, it's only complex while they're alive. Once they're dead or dying, it's very simple. You shock them or you do chest compressions. So pressure's off, right? The pressure's off. Now they're just fun, right? Okay? So don't get caught up in the stress of the moment. Have a systematic approach, okay? If you weren't there, they were going to die anyway. So they might as well enjoy the moment, right? So here's how I do it. It's true.
I'm awake.
If you weren't there, they are going to die anyways, right? Your job is to intervene to prevent death, right? If we can. And it is a losing battle because everybody dies, right? It is a losing battle. Why the hell do we even go into this profession, right? Because what my ultimate goal is will eventually be trumped by reality, okay? But every once in a while, they'll get a couple more years out of them. Usually it's like 2 or 3 years because they're all 80 or 90, right? But every once in a while, like this last week, some guys resuscitated a 32-year-old woman, and she is totally neurologically intact, and she's going to be fine. And she's got now 50 more years of life ahead of her if everything goes well, right? In terms of the number of years saved, that is a phenomenal impact on society.
What was her underlying diagnosis?
Pulmonary embolus.
That was right?
Big pulmonary embolus. Yep. Big pulmonary embolus. And you can see it on the EKG from the field.
Did you bring that one in? Is that the one you brought in?
That 32-year-old collapsed.
Yeah, respiratory stress on the line with 911 by the time we got there.
Yeah, do you have the 12-lead? Okay. Anywho, she had a classic core pulmonale right heart strain pattern. Remember I said you can diagnose thrombus PE, thrombus MI? You can see that on a 12-lead. Nobody looks because everybody says, oh, I don't see a STEMI, right? Because that's the only thing they're looking for, right? So, oh, no STEMI, right? So I don't know. Well, there's a bunch of other H's and T's. One of them is a pulmonary embolus. This woman got, they didn't even take her to the CT scan to diagnose it. They didn't want to put her. She's unstable. So based on the EKG and an echocardiogram done at the bedside, they gave her a massive dose of tPA. She lived. She survived, right? So every once in a while, we get an opportunity to intervene, right? Every once in a while. So the pressure is totally off. Here's how I do it. Rate, rhythm, axis, intervals, ischemia. Yes.
I'm stuck on axes again.
We're going to go back into it. We are going to go into axis after we talk about rate and rhythms.
Okay.
We'll be back there, I promise. I promise.
No, I understand how to find them. I just don't understand why they matter.
Extend, you don't understand why we look for them?
What does it matter?
Why does it matter to
you? If it's extreme deviated.
Because it's part of the language of the EKG. And just because you don't like to use adjectives to describe your nouns doesn't mean that they're not beneficial. Right? So just because the tree, I see a tree, does a sufficient job of describing the event, I see a beautiful maple tree is a better way to say it, right? So all I'm doing is giving you more opportunity to use the language of ECGs. We'll get into it so that you can use it more often, but you're absolutely right. Sometimes it doesn't matter 2 cents, and it has no impact at all on the patient's experience, their pathology, their survival, etc., right? But every once in a while, you might say, well, shit, I think that's coming from the ventricle. And if it's coming from the ventricle, it should have retrograde axis, right? So sometimes it might help you. Other times, it won't at all, right? When you look at a guy and you say, is that a STEMI? Or does that person have left ventricular hypertrophy? Well, left ventricular hypertrophy can mimic a STEMI sometimes, right? And if I really don't, because people with left ventricular hypertrophy can still have a heart attack. They can have a big, big fat left ventricle, right? Or they could be having a heart attack. Well, I say that's clearly left axis deviation, which is characteristic of left ventricular hypertrophy. I'm going to lean more towards LVH than calling it a pre-hospital STEMI. Okay? So at times, it will be at your advantage to know it. Will it be beneficial on everyone? Absolutely not. It's just more of the language of ECGs. Okay?
It's going to be your first patient out in
the
field by yourself.
Make sense? Okay, great. You have to know the basic measurements. Okay? Basic measurements. Big boxes are 0.2 seconds. So 5 boxes make up 1 second. Okay? 5 big boxes make up a second. Each big box is 0.2 seconds. And each little box is 0.04 seconds. Okay? Remember I said 3 little boxes define the boundaries of 120 milliseconds of a QRS complex? Well, 3 little boxes of 0.04 is 0.120. That's 120 milliseconds, right? So I just use the boxes as a quick way to gauge it, but you need to know what they represent, okay? So when I'm trying to get a quick rate, I just count the R to R interval, knowing that each big box, if I break them down, this is 300, 150, 100, 75, 60, 50. And technically you can go 43, 38, but once you're less than 50, you're bradycardic and I don't give a damn, right? So I just say 300, 150, 100, 75, 60, 50. Okay? And that's big boxes. So I pick an R wave and I start counting big boxes until I hit my next R wave. And however many boxes that is tells me my rate. 300, 150, 100, 75. I'm writing 75 beats a minute. Okay? And this one,
start at the beginning of my QRS complex because it lines up on a bold mark there, right? 300, 150, 100, 75, 60, 50. I don't care. It's bradycardic. Right? I mean, seriously, right? I mean, practical. Be practical. Okay? If you want to memorize 4338, go right ahead. Okay? But just memorize 300, 150, 100, 75, 60, 50. Okay? 300, 150, 100, 75, 60, 50. Okay.
Doc, is there a preferred method on the different, like of the four, is there a more preferred or just whatever you use for the first time?
What do you mean of
the
four methods?
Like the 6 second trip or the 1500
method?
Oh, I don't care. Whatever you want
to
do.
This has to be for
regular
rhythm.
Right. This has to be regular rhythm. Yep, absolutely. Has to be regular. Okay? Unless you have an irregular rhythm, then you can say big hash marks. Right? Generally, the sections that divide up your 12 lead, right? Those are 3 second intervals. They're 15 big boxes to each one of those sections. So I just take two of those. So I'll take three in AVF and I count them out. That gives me 6 seconds. I divide up or I multiply it by 10. That gives me my rate. Okay? So in this circumstance, I take two big hash marks, so I look at 15 boxes is 3 seconds, 30 boxes is 6 seconds, and I count them out and I multiply it by 10, right? So what's my rate of this irregular rhythm?
160.
All right, close enough. It's fast, right? Fast, pathologically fast, okay? Clearly, I've got two separate rhythms going on here, right? A fast rhythm that looks like it aborted, and now I'm back into sinus rhythm. So my pathological rhythm was what?
SPT.
Rate. We're not even there yet. Rate. I just want to know rates. What's my rate of my fast rhythm?
Just over 150.
300, 150. So in between 150 and 300. It's a big jump, right? So usually the importance is over 150 is pretty much pathologic, right? So we have caution about rhythms at 150. Generally over 150, you're bad. So I'd say it's like 180, 200. Does it matter? No, doesn't matter. We're going to put me in that same pathologic window. Still going to give me a small cluster of rhythms that I know fall into that range. Okay? What about my sinus rhythm after recovery? How fast is that? 300, 150, 100. Okay.
Quick question on terminology and reading scripts and stuff. So yesterday when I was sitting down with Seth, he was talking about how if it's regular,
right,
and then you have an interruption in your rhythm, then it's irregular.
Right.
But if you have an irregular and then an interruption and you have a regular, how do you want us to write that?
I'll tell you in just a moment when we get to rhythms. But right now we're just on rate. The next one, remember, rate, rhythm, axis, intervals, ischemia. I know you guys are excited about axis. You're excited about rhythm. We will get there, I promise. Okay? So, how fast is this rate?
300, 150, 100,
75,
50.
70? 70-ish, right? Falls into normal sinus range. That's all I care about. Right? I care about ranges. Okay? So 50 to 100 means something to me. Okay? 100 to 150, yeah, there's a couple things that can go in there. There's only a few things that are going to be 150 or greater. There's very rare things that are going to be 200 or greater. Right? Everything below 50 is just bradycardic. I don't care. Right? Okay? So, what's the diagnostic importance? Anything over 100 is tachycardia, right? Anything less than 50 is bradycardia. Okay? Got it? Rate. Rate is easy. Yeah?
Your last slide there is sinus equals 50 to 100?
Yeah, that's because everybody wants to say 60 to 100, but I say 50.
50.
Just, yeah, because you see so many healthy people or so many people on beta blockers that are 50 to 100. I just like to put it at 50 to 100.
That's at 48.
Yeah,
48's bradycardia.
Relax.
And then
that's what I was wondering. Right?
Like, I'm totally fit, and I'm probably, like, resting heart rate of 38 right now. I doubt it.
Totally fit.
Totally kidding.
I don't feel totally fit.
Yeah, I'm soft.
Looking at myself in the mirror, I'm a little soft.
Get out.
Flex. And I'm breathing now.
Rhythm. Okay? Here you go. Rhythms.
Tachycardias. We're going to go fast rhythms and then we're going to go slow rhythms. Okay? So, the most common sign of illness and the biggest alarm we have physiologically that something ain't right is a rapid heart rate. Okay? So, what normally accelerates your pulse rate?
Fear.
Fear. But what does that?
Sympathetic
nervous system, right?
Hotel Bates, it looks like.
Yep, that'll do it. Epinephrine, or norepinephrine, or cocaine, or methamphetamine, or any of these sympathomimetics, right? Sympathomimetics are drugs that mimic the sympathetic nervous system, or give you a epinephrine, norepinephrine, or similar catecholamine surge, right? So, in response to stress, epi, or norepi, is released from the adrenal glands, and it gives you that fight-or-flight response. I get elevated heart rate, which is inotrope, which is chronotrope, right? I get faster depolarization and transfer of my signal, which is dromotrope, and I get a stronger squeeze, which is inotrope, right? So remember, back to your question about how do I influence the individual cell? Well, let's look at my SA node. This is the action potential of my SA node. And I can influence the slope and rate of reaching that point of threshold depolarization. I can change the rate and integrity of that membrane and determine or impact automaticity by applying a sympathetic tone, which gives me a more rapid depolarization rate and a quicker event, versus my sympathetic or parasympathetic vagal tone, which is slower all the way through. Does that make sense? Well, I can impact these portions of the cell or of the heart, okay? Epinephrine can only make your heart go so fast, and the general rule is 220 beats minus your age. Okay? So 220 beats minus your age is what you can achieve with sinus tachycardia. Right? So, actually, this is an old slide. So I'm a little older than that, but like a year. Okay? But a neonate can go 220 beats a minute. Okay? I'm 38 years old, so I can go, what is that, 182 beats now? Okay? If I can go 182 beats, right? My old man just turned 67, I think. So he can go 153, right? And I can achieve that with catecholamine impact or influence, okay? I can achieve that under a stressful situation. I can achieve that through sinus tachycardia, okay? I rarely will reach the upper threshold limit of that, but it's important to know, could this be a pathologic fast rhythm, or could this be a physiologic fast rhythm? Meaning, is my rhythm a manifestation of some other process, like sepsis, methamphetamines, fear, right? Or do I have a primary cardiac problem where my problem is the rhythm itself, not my rhythm is a manifestation of my problem? Does that make sense? Pathologic rhythms are intrinsic to the heart. The problem started in the heart. Physiologic sinus tachycardia could be a whole host of conditions, okay, which are not treated with ACLS drugs, which are not treated with electricity, right? They're treated with IV fluids if I'm in hemorrhagic shock, or blood, right? They're treated with IV fluids and antibiotics if I'm in sepsis. They're treated with relaxation techniques if I'm stressed, right? So,
the max heart rate is only for the epinephrine portion, but not for like.
Right, not for pathologic. Right. Because, right, there's times where I'm going to go potentially faster than 220 beats per minute. It's rare, but it's possible. So, really, when we talk about tachycardias, you have sinus tachycardia and you have everything else. But that's the first fork in the road. When I look at that and I see a rate, and I say that that rate is fast, my first fork in the road is that sinus tachycardia or is that some other pathologic rhythm? Okay? And I know that sounds totally basic and totally simple, but it means a hell of a lot in determining what your primary problem is. Okay? Pulmonary embolus gives me sinus tachycardia, a potentially devastating condition, right? But I don't shock to cure pulmonary embolus, right? I don't give ACLS drugs to treat pulmonary embolus unless I deteriorate to PEA, which is a primary cardiac condition, okay? So I'm either sinus tachycardia or I'm PSVT, I'm AFib, I'm A-flutter, I'm VTAC, right? So I'm either sinus tach or I'm everything else, okay? So here's my questions for rhythm analysis. This is what I say to myself. One, what's my rate? Okay, we already talked about rate. Now I want to know rhythm. So one, am I regular or irregular? Okay, am I regular or am I irregular? If I am irregular, does it happen in a predictable pattern or is it purely chaotic? If it's chaotic and there is no rhyme or reason, I am irregularly irregular. If there is some pattern to it, then I am regularly irregular. Does that make sense? I know it seems like semantics. I have a guy who used to fish with Russ Roundy. Actually, he died of cancer. He's one of my partners. He was a doc over at Sacred Heart. And this guy could catch fish like you wouldn't believe. And I don't know what the hell it was. He just knew how to catch fish. We'd go fly fishing, right? I remember one time we were out at down south by Badger Lake, Williams Lake. We're out fishing Williams Lake. I'm sitting right next to him. Actually, we're in like float tubes. Right next to him. Right next to him. Same exact everything. Same exact fly. Same exact. And I would say, what are you doing? And every time I'd ask him about how he was stripping the stripping pattern, he would always say it in arrhythmia. Right? So he said it. AFib at about 75. So I'm irregular at about that rate, right? And he'd still catch twice as many fish, right? Or it'd be bijiminy, right? So, right? So that's how he'd say it. He'd say it at that rate and that pattern, right? And I still couldn't catch the damn fish that he was catching. But that's how we describe it. So are you regular or irregular? If I am irregular, I'm predictable, or I am unpredictable. Okay? That's how we speak the language of regularity.
So it doesn't matter which comes first.
Doesn't matter.
Okay.
Regularly irregular or regularly irregular?
We can throw in a PVC once in a while.
I'm irregular.
You're irregular.
It's irregular. Well, at that moment, it is irregular. Now I have to say, okay, overall, this is a regular rhythm. I have one little piddly beat that is irregular, right? Well, that's an irregular beat as opposed to a global irregular pattern, right? But technically, that's regular, right? So, question number two. Are all P waves paired with a QRS? Okay? Does every P wave have a QRS? And what that tells me is I have intact conduction that originates in the atrium and conducts through to the ventricle. If I don't have a regular P wave, then I know I'm dealing with a cluster of non-atrial origin rhythms. Okay? There's only a handful of atrial rhythms. Okay? There's only a handful of non-atrial rhythms. So I want to know, do I have a P wave paired with every QRS complex? Okay? That's question number two. Question number three, am I narrow or am I wide? And we know about narrow and wide. Right? Narrow complex means I am using the rapid conduction pathway of the heart. I originate at the level of the AV node or higher versus a wide complex, which usually means I am ventricular in origin or I'm dealing with a diseased conduction system. Okay? So those are my questions. Regular, irregular. P wave with QRS, narrow or wide? Got it? So, regularly irregular and fast. Remember, we're dealing with fast rhythms now. Regularly irregular is usually going to be bijiminy. Okay? I've got a normal P wave with a QRS followed by a ventricular beat. Right? Or ventricular conduction. Not all of which are associated with a pulse, right? So sometimes if it's too early, I never had time to fill, so I don't get the mechanical benefit because I never filled all the way. Okay? So I can have bijiminy that's non-perfusing, or I can have bijiminy that's perfusing, and I tell that by a pulse, right? And I probably get a little bit of squeeze, but not enough to generate a pulse because I never gave myself time to fill. Okay? Still had electrical activity, I just couldn't pair it with anything meaningful. Okay? But it's a predictable pattern, right? Starts in the atrium, rapid conduction, followed by a ventricular beat. And I know that's ventricular because it's not preceded by a P wave, that's the T wave, right? Not preceded by a P wave, and it's wide. So, ventricular.
Will that always be T? There's only one hump in between your two QRS complexes. I mean, it could be, I understand P could be buried in there.
You could bury a P wave in there. Generally, that will always be a T wave. Okay? Because you can't not have a repolarization event. Okay?
I can't think of an example, but I know in our ventricular packet there was somewhere it was like,
It's hard to tell. And sometimes the P waves and the T waves look really similar. And you have to just say, all right, where would I expect the P wave to be and mark them out? And then I mark theoretically where it should be, and then I find my T waves and I march them out, and I mark theoretically where they should be, and then I try and decide, you know what, that's a T and a P happening at the same time, so I just got one big bump instead of two little bumps. Okay?
So non-perfusing, so if you're palpating a pulse with TVT, non-perfusing is when you feel that skip.
So non-perfusing, if I see this rhythm, and the guy's bradycardic, right?
Yeah.
Then it's a non-perfusing PVC.
Okay, so if you
if I'm only feeling this beat,
right.
I'm regular. Okay. It feels regular, but my rhythm is irregular, right? I'm feeling regular because I'm only feeling what is perfused,
okay,
which
so
is regular, right?
So if you have somebody who has the PVC, you're palpating with pulse,
yeah, palpating.
And they are marching along, so you have the regular rate, and then you have a PVC, and you don't feel anything.
It's a non-perfusing PVC,
okay.
Right. So in this circumstance, if when I look at this, and then I feel my pulse, and I feel beat, 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 I'm non-perfusing, right? If I look at this, and then I look at my pulse, and I go beat, 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 and I'm perfusing that PVC, okay? But this is mechanical. Don't confuse pulse.
No, because if you're bijiminy,
electrical
it's like
conduction.
Half of what your actual pulse is, correct?
If it's perfusing.
Yeah.
Or if it's not perfusing.
Yeah.
Right.
So somebody just shows you that, let's say, I don't know, on a test. What's your rate?
What's my rate? I would say I have an atrial rate. If I was to answer a question, what's my rate? I'd say I have an atrial rate of 300, 150, 100, 79, 60, 50. Was it 48?
Ish.
So I'd say I got I'm like mid-40s, 45. I got an atrial rate of 45 with bijiminy. That's what I would say.
Mm-hmm.
The atrial rate of 45 is by Jimin.
Or, like a sex line, if it's not perfusing, then you don't have that.
Doesn't matter. I didn't ask you about perfusion. I asked you about electrical rhythm. Right? What's the rate?
Now you say atrial rate. Could you call it sinus?
Yeah, it is sinus by Jimin. But I say atrial because I'm trying to generalize things. Yeah. If we have an upright P wave in lead 2, and if everything axis-wise looks normal for that P wave, then I'm just going to assume it's sinus. Okay.
Typically, that should perfuse, right? You should feel that since it's a ventricle beat.
It depends, though. Look here. I've got an event here. I've got a repolarization phase.
Right.
This should be my relaxation phase, which is when I fill the ventricle, right?
Pre-load.
So if I go right. So if I go like this, squeeze down, and then I go squeeze. I haven't filled. So a lot of times I won't feel anything because that second electrical event is not paired with adequate filling. Okay. Now sometimes I'll be able to feel something. It just won't feel as strong. But it's because I have impaired filling because it's such a short beat immediately after. Sometimes I'm feeling just fine with Bijimin, and I'll feel all.
When the ventricle's repolarizing, though, it could be filling, right? Because it's not squeezed down while it's repolarizing.
Right, but this the time frame here is, what are we looking at here? This is 0.2, 0.4 seconds. That's less than half a second. And it's really hard to fill adequately in less than half a second. So I'm going to have an impaired beat. Sure. I might get some in there. And think about a normal ejection fraction. I'm only kicking out 60% of what was there. So technically, I still have 40% in the ventricle. So even a 40% ejection fraction still has something to squeeze, right? It just depends on how much I'm going to get out of it. But again, let's not put perfusion into this picture. This is strict. We're still electrical, okay?
Does the Jimin terms only relate to ventricular rhythms?
No.
It can also relate to like
you can
ABCs,
have atrial
right?
Bijimini. You can have junctional bijimini. I can have atrial trigimini. I can have ventricular quadrigimini, right?
So when you said sinus brady with bijimini, you would actually have to say sinus brady
with ventricular bijimini. Ventricular bijimini. That's what I would say. Sinus rhythm with ventricular bijimini.
So
sinus rhythm with atrial bijimini.
Does atrial bijimini look the same?
No.
What's
because atrial rhythms use the rapid conduction pathway in our narrow complex, not wide complex. Remember, wide and narrow. What do I know about wide? I know wide is ventricular in origin or a diseased conduction pathway. Now, if I had narrow, I could have a bundle branch block, which could make me wide, right? Could make me wide. But if I had a bundle branch block, I can't have a bundle branch block here and not have it here and have it here, right? So if I've got a healthy conduction pathway, I'm going to assume this isn't a bundle branch block making it wide. I'm going to assume it's ventricular in origin making it wide. Because I can conduct very healthily down a normal pathway with a narrow beat.
Okay. I think your next slide shows it.
Irregular is almost always... atrial fibrillation, okay? Except when it's not. But if I had to guess 9 times out of 10, just based on statistical, based on the prevalence of the disease, I would say it's going to be AFib, okay? And it is irregularly irregular. Why is it irregularly irregular? Well, remember my analogy of the pond, the pristine, calm pond, right? And I take a pebble and I throw it up and it drops in the middle of the pond and I see a ripple. It's beautiful, right? I get this nice, beautiful wave of depolarization. That's from a single pacemaker, right? Atrial fibrillation is like taking a handful of gravel and going and throwing it up in the air. And what do I get? Right? And I get all kinds of signaling that overlaps with each other and bounces off of each other. And I have this little AV node down at the bottom. It's like, I'll take that one. I'll take that one and that one and this one. I'll take that one, right? So whenever it's ready, it takes one, okay? And that's why it's irregularly irregular. Does that make sense? Okay. Yeah.
Why is the, what I'm assuming is the RS, why is it inverted and so large?
This RS?
Yes.
Depends on which lead it is and depends on where I'm looking at it from. So maybe it's lead one and I have right axis deviation.
So
it's
right? Not really inverted, it's the lead that we're looking at.
No, it's not. Nothing is inverted about it. There's nothing inverted about this. Right? We talk about inverted P waves because we know there's a standard for a P wave when it's sinus. Okay? When I talk about this, I say it's an RS. It's an RS. There's no Q. I don't see a Q anywhere. I just see the RS. And what this means to me is that the majority of that depolarization event of the ventricle happened within one box, two box, three box. Barely makes my criteria of three boxes, but happened within three boxes and was predominantly away from whatever lead this was. Okay?
You don't have to have a P wave for these ones? Because it's not originating in the sinus node, but it's originating in the atrium, so that's why you know it's narrow.
Right, so, right, exactly. Okay. So what you will sometimes get is this crap right here, right? I'll see a bunch of junk in here, okay? Nothing that's really discrete. Sometimes I won't see anything. But most of the time I just see a bunch of noise, because that's what it is. It's that big group, handful of pebbles on the pond. It's just a bunch of noise. And nothing has the opportunity to make a nice event, which is nicely seen as a single event through the atrium. It's just a bunch of the quiver, okay? It technically looks like V-fib, just on a much smaller scale because it's much less muscle, okay? Because it's the same process, fibrillation, okay? Fact, there it is, right? So I get a bunch of chaotic signaling, no organized P wave activity, they randomly conduct, and I usually am less than 200 beats a minute, because what I need to know is that generally there is a rate limitation in adults. It's hard for me to conduct an atrial rhythm to the ventricles at rates faster than 200. In general, it's hard, okay? Never say never, but any rate over 200, something ain't right, okay? I can't conduct that fast through the AV node as an adult, okay? So rates over 200, that's an important rate cutoff. So 150 is important for reasons we'll talk about in a second, but over 200, it is hard to conduct a rhythm above the AV node, meaning from atrial and origin, at a rate faster than 200. Because the AV node just has an intrinsic rate limitation, an upper limit of what it conduct at. Okay? And generally, it doesn't want to conduct faster than 200.
So without getting into pediatrics, why does a smaller heart can handle bigger?
Why can they? I don't know why the hell they can. I don't know. Why can a mouse beat it? Like, there, maybe it has to do with body surface to mass ratio. I don't know. Because little animals beat faster. They have higher metabolism rates. I don't know. That's a damn good question. I can't answer that. I can't answer that. I just know as you age, you slow down.
That's because it's just
getting old. It's just life. Life wears on you, right? Okay. See, there's my regular rhythm picture. See how regular that pebble on the pond is? Okay? So what are my rate...
Is sinus arrhythmia one of the only ones that can be irregular? Irregular?
No. So I can have sinus. So there's other... Let's just talk briefly about some of these other ones, okay? So let's talk about some of the other irregularly irregular rhythms, which will come up here in just a second. But... AFib is generally my most common irregularly irregular rhythm, right? Multifocal atrial tachycardia, which is multiple different pacemakers, but not as many as in AFib, which is thousands and bazillions of little fibrillating pacemakers, right? Total chaos. But multifocal atrial tachycardia or a wandering pacemaker is three or four discrete pacemaker sites that are all competing, okay? And so I will see distinct P waves, and I'll see a repeated morphology to that P wave. One might be inverted, and I'll see that same inverted P wave for a series of beats, and it should have its own rate to it, okay? So I can take that rate, and I can pull those ones out and say, all right, that makes sense, okay? And generally, if one gets out-competed, it won't pace, and so he might have not been there, but in general, it's going to be in a certain rate group, okay? Then I'll see another P wave shape that might be like a biphasic P wave. So maybe one will look like this and have a QRS complex. And then I'll see one that kind of looks like this in a QRS complex. And then I'll see one that's a big tall peaked one like this in a QRS complex. Okay? And I'll see this repeated pattern of these different P wave morphologies. Which all that means is when I looked at it from this perspective, right? When I look at this heart from this perspective and I see three different pacemakers from the atrium, maybe one's over here in the left atrium, who knows, right? So I see three different pacemakers. They all have, well, it's just gonna be that one because they're gonna go. We'll do that one, and we'll do this one, okay? They're all going to depolarize differently. This one will go this way, this one will go this way, this one will go this way, right? In terms of how I depolarize that atrium. So they're all gonna look a little bit different in size and shape, okay? Maybe one that's dead right in the middle is gonna depolarize this way and this way, so it's gonna look like this, okay? So I see discrete P waves, but that goes back to my first or my second question. Do I have discrete P waves with every QRS? If the answer is yes, then I know I'm atrial in origin. And if they're discrete, and I can find a pattern, then I'm going to say, all right, it's a wandering pacemaker. And if my rate's over 100, it's multifocal atrial tachycardia. Who gets these atrial arrhythmias? What makes my atrium irritable?
People on digitalis.
Digitalis, that's like, you can't say that. That's like, digitalis makes everything. I mean, that's like,
that's what we learned.
So,
caffeine?
No.
Caffeine
is a caffeine is an irritant and it can do it. But generally, there's a population of people who get atrial arrhythmias. And they have dilated atrium. So instead of a normal shaped atrium, they have a dilated left atrium. So instead of being normal, I got this big stretched out atrium. What gives me a stretched out right atrium?
Excessive preload
can, but that's usually not a chronic condition that stretches.
Right-sided heart failure?
Right-sided heart failure, or high right-sided pressures, right? What gives me high right-sided pressures? What kind of hypertension?
Pulmonary
disease, right? So if you give me shitty lungs, and I'm pushing against resistance, fibrosis, scarring, thick tissue, then I get high right ventricle pressures and a dilated right atrium. People with COPD, people with pulmonary embolism. This is called cor pulmonale. Okay? So multifocal atrial tachycardia you see in primarily COPD patients because they got this dilated stretched out right atrium and little irritable focus or foci that all want to be pacemakers. How do you treat the underlying condition? Or how do you treat the arrhythmia? Treat the underlying condition. You don't do anything. You treat their COPD. Treat their hypoxia. Get their rate and take away their sympathetic drive that they're having in the COPD exacerbation. Okay? So So a lot of these atrial arrhythmias are related to people with underlying lung disease. Okay, it'll be a common theme. AFib, you'll see AFib a lot in people with COPD, long-standing COPD. You'll see AFib sometimes as a manifestation of a big pulmonary embolus. Okay?
How about CHF?
CHF is a left-sided thing in general. Okay? So you won't see the dilated right atrium as much, except for bad CHF, left-sided disease creates lung disease, which creates right-sided failure. So severe people will have both sides.
Well, because you see a lot of CHF in COPD. So that's basically straight.
Yep.
So with the wandering atrial pacemaker, you know, they say if there's three different morphologies, and that's
less than a rate of 100,
but is
a wandering pacemaker.
Is it that small of a number, or is there like, is there a lot of different places that the pacemaker is
coming from?
No,
it's usually like two or three.
So it's just a handful.
Yeah. Okay. You'll be able to look at it and be like, that's discrete P waves.
Because the P waves will continue to repeat.
Right, they'll repeat on themselves. And okay. it will correlate with a organized depolarization of the atrium. Okay? A definable event that can be seen on a surface EKG. Okay? So what are my regular rhythms? Sinus tachycardia, we talked about that. Flutter. PSVT or AV nodal reentry tachycardia.
Quiet.
And VTAC. Okay? So atrial flutter is a reentry pathway. So instead of having a bunch of chaos in the atrium, what I have is a cycling through the atrium. I have a reentry pathway. Instead of depolarizing point A to point B, it depolarizes in a loop. Okay? And you kind of get this reentry phenomenon through the atrium. And it intrinsically wants to occur at a rate of 300 beats a minute. Generally, it wants to occur at a rate of 300 beats a minute. Okay? So it is a regular rhythm because it happens at a regular cycle. Okay? It's a cycling pattern with a predictable rate. Okay? Does that make sense?
Yeah, but how is it getting through the AV junction into the bundle of hits if it's circling it?
So I'm still going to hit this. Every time I pass by it, I'm going to hit it, right? I'm going to loop, and I'm going to hit it. I'm going to loop. It's like if I ran around the track, every time I run around the track, I give you a high five, boom, right? And I make another lap. And I come back around again, and I go, and I smack you again. And I come back around again, and I go, bam, and smack you again, right? Every time I come around and I hit that AV node, I trigger it, okay?
So, kind of like a speed bag, right? You're just constantly hitting it, but you said earlier you can't have a rate over 200.
Exactly. So, how do I see atrial flutter? I see atrial flutter manifest typically at either 2-to-1 conduction, where it's a rate of 150 beats a minute. It looks just like sinus tachycardia because my second P wave is buried in the QRS complex. So I'm always suspicious of sinus tachycardia rate of 150. If I get a rate of 150, I'm always suspicious that it's flutter with 2-to-1 conduction. And I have to really look at it closely, and I usually look at leads V1 and V2, because for me, it's easier to see flutter waves in V1 and V2. It's not normal cycling. It usually cycles this way, so I feel like I see them better. But I'll tell you, sometimes I can't tell the difference. And so generally what I'll do is I'll give them a bolus of fluid, give you a liter of fluid. I'll have you bagel down. A flutter is really refractory to treatment. It doesn't want to budge. That's the clue. When I see it, it's pegged at 150. This guy's 150, 150, 150, 150, or 145, 145, 145, because not everybody's going to be perfectly 300, but right around 300. Now, if I cut it in half, and I'm just pegged at that rate, doesn't matter what I do, I can't stop that runaway pattern. If it was sinus tachycardia, I treat your fever, it comes down. I give you a fluid volume bolus, it comes down, it settles at 130, 120. Give you some more fluids, you settle down to 110, right? That's not what happens with flutter. Sometimes if you vagal down, right, have them blow on their thumb as hard as you can, you can get them to go 3-to-1 conduction, 4-to-1, and I can manifest flutter waves, okay? But 150 I'm always cautious of. Okay?
What causes it?
It's just a reentry pathway. There's a lot of people who have atrial fibrillation get it. It's usually irritable, dilated atria. But it's really, you'll see a lot of people with AFib flutter, where they kind of do one or the other. So they kind of run in the same circles, like meth heads and heroin addicts, right? You're both kind of hang out with the same dudes, right? So you'll see. And then if I cycle every third event, then I'm usually rate of 100. If I cycle every fourth event, I'm a rate of 75. If I cycle every fifth event, I'm a rate of 60. Remember this sequence? 300, 150, 100, 75, 60, 50, right? So when you look at flutter waves, they generally will be one box each. You'll have a flutter wave for each box, okay? Or at least in the same pattern. So when I see flutter waves at 300 beats a minute, that's what I got, okay? Or I'll take my little calipers, and I'll find a P wave, and I'll set it to one big box, and then I'll go and look at P waves and march them out and see if I can make another P wave fall out somewhere, even if it's just like a little notch in there, right? So it comes in like this, and then I get a little notch like this, okay? And then I get my next P wave right here. So I'd say, all right, here's my big box like this. Here's my next big box like this. So I find a P wave and I say, I should have another one right here. And sure enough, sure shit, there's a little thing, a little bump right there. And then I say, all right, I think it's 2-1 flutter. Okay? Does that make sense for flutter? Now, you one thing, and I know this is going to piss you off, but you never say never in medicine. Never say never. I just reviewed a chart today before I came here of someone who sent me an EKG, a past medic student, who's very smart, said, I had this very weird rhythm. It was going at a rate of about 280, 260, 280. The guy looked terrible. It would go from narrow to wide. It was hard to determine. I'd never seen anything like it. It was 3-1, or it was 1-1 flutter. 1-1 flutter. Never seen it before. It was narrow complex at a rate of 280. Which correlates with what the cycling, why the guy could conduct, I have no clue. When they synchronized cardioverted, he went back to a sinus rhythm. I wondered if he had a bypass pathway like Wolf Parkinson White, which is a way you can sneak signals through without going through the AV node. It doesn't have the intrinsic rate limitations of the AV node, but he didn't.
Or maybe he did, I didn't see it.
So weird shit can happen. So never say never. But generally, you will be in a rate of 150, 100, 75, 60, or 50, and it'll make that very characteristic sawtooth pattern. Okay? Flutter. So, 2-1, looks like sinus tap at 150, right? Peg, 150. There you go. Here's a bold mark. 300, 150. 300, 150. P wave. P wave. I can't find another P wave in there, right? First of all, it's blurry as shit, but it's 150 paid sinus tap. I'm always suspicious, okay? Now I can start to see flutter waves, and look at that. They kind of go through at rates of 300 beats a minute. Same here, one per big box. Same here, right? Per big, well, that one's not as, but this is variable. One, two, three. So this is variable conduction. Sometimes it's conducting every second. Sometimes it's conducting every third. So this one is irregularly irregular, but I have defined, definite P-wave morphology. Okay? Flutter. PSVT, or AVNRT, AV nodal reentry tachycardia, SVT, is a conglomerate of conditions. Okay? But generally what it is anything that cycles on the AV node. And it has its own inherent little circuit that runs away on itself. We talked about it with the diagram the other day of coming into the AV node, a fast pathway and a slow pathway, right? And generally, I'll send a slow signal this way that'll get canceled out by the rapid signal that comes this way. But if I break this somehow, it'll cycle on itself and run away from you. Okay? So my rhythm originates at the AV node, so my QRS complex is not preceded by a P wave. So the definition of PSVT is I got a QRS that is rapid, regular, narrow complex, and doesn't have a P wave. And if I do see a P wave, it's usually a retrograde P wave after the QRS complex. And you should know why, right? Because I'm depolarizing it this way as opposed to this way.
Is P polymorphic or whatever?
Paroxysmal supraventricular, which happens. It comes in, it happens, and it goes away. Happens, goes away.
What's the difference between
the SVT and the AV node? SVT defines anything above the AV node. Any rhythm that is supraventricular, or above the ventricles, any rhythm that is supraventricular in etiology. AV nodal reentry tachycardia is what we commonly call SVT. Technically, SVT is a much broader category of rhythms. But for the EMS provider, the vast majority of EMS physicians, the vast majority of ER docs, vast majority of internal medicine docs, family medicine docs, refer to AVNRT as PSVT. Now, when I talk to electrophysiologists in cardiology, then you've got to be like, I think it's AVNRT or some other thing, right? Because when you say, well, I think it's PSVT, and they say, well, which one? I'm like, come on, man. Just hang out with the rest of us, please, right? But it's true, but they have to define it in more detail. But generally what we call SVT, you won't get SVT wrong on the test if it's AVNRT and you say SVT, okay? Because that's how we define it. And even if you look at ACLS, they call AVNRT SVT, okay? We're talking about that. So here's an example. What's my rate?
150.
Fast, right?
Yeah.
That's faster than 150.
That's
fast.
Yeah.
It's greater than 200, I can tell you that.
200.
Right?
It's
faster than sinus tach, I know that. Right? It's greater than 200, which it makes me really suspicious for anything that originates in the atrium. Right? We talked about that. But it's narrow complex, meaning it's using the rapid conduction pathway of the heart, so that leaves me SVT, really, right? I could be flutter with one-to-one conduction, but I've seen that once, right? So we're not going to call it that again, and it was just earlier today. So, right? So I'm narrow complex, rapid, right? This is not a P wave, that's the end of the T, that's the T wave, okay? This might be a retrograde T wave that I'm seeing here, or a retrograde P wave that I'm seeing here, I'm sorry. Right? You might be able to argue that. But otherwise, it is fast, narrow, and regular. Fast, narrow, and regular is SVT. Particularly if it's over between 180, 220 beats a minute, 240, that's SVT. Okay? Make sense? Okay, what's my other regular rhythm? VTAC. What's the difference between VTAC and all these other ones? That's why, because it starts in the ventricle, right? So it seems pretty damn easy, right? What are my fast rhythms? Well, my fast regular rhythms are flutter, sinus tach, SVT, or VTAC. Or any of the narrow complex ones paired with a bundle branch block, then they're all going to be wide complex tachycardia. That's where it gets difficult, okay? Right?
Cool.
So you can make it really confusing. But in general, I have three or four fast rhythms, right, that I need to know. Some of them are narrow complex, some of them are wide complex. VTAC is my wide complex rhythm. It is regular, okay? VTAC is regular. VTAC is not irregular. If you see irregular, then assume that it's AFib with a bundle branch block. Okay? Because VTAC is regular. It is a pacemaker. It has a cadence, just like sinus has a cadence. It is not chaotic. It is a cadence beat. Okay? It can be monomorphic, which generally is a scar-related phenomenon. So somebody who's had an MI in the past, someone who's got some underlying abnormality that makes them want to do this, one of the first questions I ask people in VTAC, if they're alert, is, have you had a heart attack? Or a wide complex tachycardia. Have you had a heart attack? If they say yes, then VTAC moves up on my differential diagnosis. If they say no, then I think, no previous scar-related morphology puts VTAC a lot lower on my differential. Okay? But people who have MIs, or people who are having an MI, right, it's generally going to be monomorphic VTAC. Polymorphic VTAC has beat-to-beat variations in morphology. It's called torsades, right? And generally is related to problems with conduction, QT prolongation, cardiotoxic overdoses, okay? Drugs that make people have a long QT, drugs that make people have QRS widening, people with genetic problems with their channels, right? So genetic, inherited mutations of cardiac channels, okay? If it's less than 30 seconds, it's non-sustained VTAC. If it's 31 seconds or more, it's sustained VTAC, okay?
Where in the world do you measure QT from and that stuff?
You don't.
Oh, you don't?
No.
Well, how do you know it's prolonged?
You know, once you convert them out and they go back into the sinus rhythm, you measure their QT interval and you say, that's long.
All right.
No wonder.
Yeah.
Right? But you can't measure QT on this. Yeah, you can't. Good question. You can't. It's when you convert them. Okay? But I'll tell you, we've got great examples. Ty Bruner's got a great, or not, yeah, Ty, it was Ty Bruner. He's got a great example of a woman who was on a Z-Pak, who probably had an inherited disorder making her long QT to begin with, got put on a Z-Pak, which made her longer QT, because those drugs do that, and he brought her in, it was like 2 in the morning, because he's not a lazy medic, he's like, you know what, something doesn't feel right, I'm going to go in. She had a syncopal episode. So he rode in with AMR, and sure as shit, on the way in, what does she do? She goes into torsades, right? So they're like, wasn't expecting that one. Put pads on, shocked her, she wakes up, everything's fine, right? But you look at the 12 lead, she's got long QT syndrome. So when I get people who are overdoses, I get an EKG on every overdose. Every overdose, I get an EKG. If you come in and you say, I took some pills, you're going to get a 12 lead, right? Because I'm going to look for QT prolongation, and I'm going to look for QRS widening. Because both of those can tell me that you have a toxic overdose that has potentially compromised your ability to conduct, and you're probably going to need telemetry monitoring, or I say, you're medically cleared, go sit in the psych bay, right? Make sense? So that was regular, irregular, right? So does each QRS, question number 2, does each QRS complex have a P wave and vice versa? P wave always indicates organized atrial activity. So you guys want to take a little break? Like, take like 2 minutes, 3 minutes.